dedicated to Sean's dad, my brother-in-law, Alan Hart. What you put in will determine what you get out. Continuing in our Becoming series, now Becoming as God's Universal Church. We have spent this entire year, 2016, taking a look at what it means from God's Word to be a child of God and to seek to become all of what God calls us to. Sure, even though we spent just about 10 months exploring the whole notion of becoming, we truly have only scratched the surface of all of what God intends for us, His children, to do and to be. Because our eyes have not seen, nor have our ears heard all of the many things that God has in store for those who love God, for you and for me. God's call on our lives is directly related to our ability to hear God and then to respond to God. What does that mean? Well, it means that when we are ready, when we are really or shown up ready to take on more of what God has in store for us, God will allow us a sufficient amount of grace to face the difficulties and challenges that come with every new stage in God. The Bible speaks to us about moving from milk to meat. And in that, it speaks about the need for all of us to grow up, to mature in the faith. Yes, to always approach God as a little child, we talked about that, with humility and openness and expectancy, but to grow to the point where we are totally and unequivocally dependent on God for our daily existence. So there really is no way that we could totally exhaust the subject of what it means to become all of what God has created us to be, but it is my hope that this year's messages will help all of us as we continue this lifelong journey toward becoming all that God has called us to be. When we consider the family of God, we are reminded of Jesus Christ our Lord, the only begotten Son of God, the one who Scripture teaches us is our friend and our brother, and the one who we as God's adopted children are joint heirs with, in line to inherit from God's throne. We stand in the same position as our friend and brother, Jesus the Christ, to receive all the riches and glory that our Father has in store for us. We have been grafted into the family of God, and we now share in what Paul said in Romans, the nourishing sap from the olive root. He talks about a wild branch that's been cut off and connected to a thriving olive tree. And this family of God doesn't just exist in East Preston, nor does it exist where I come from, Tampa, Florida, nor Cincinnati, where I was born. But the family of God is universal. The family of God spans countries and continents and cultures and traditions. The family of God is diverse, it is multicultural, it is filled with people from all types of backgrounds and experiences, and it is also made up of those who have things and those who do not. It's made up of the wise and the foolish, the thief and the giver, the ruler and the servant. The family of God is the most diverse in terms of cultures and traditions and races than any family at any time, unlike many of our churches. I do love traveling to different countries and meeting people and worshiping with them. I love to learn the cultural expressions or nuances, and there are differences depending on where you go in the practice of religion and the practice of our faith. And I love to experience the similarities of traditions that carry across nations, people who have never worshiped together before in their lives are doing many of the same things. When I was in seminary, I've shared before that I spent the summer in Jamaica doing my internship. And my pastor, Pastor LeQuita, was a fascinating young man. A young man who had never been to the United States, but almost knew more about it than I did, and that's where I hailed from. He would say things, he would tell me about a certain food that they had, and one I remember in particular, callaloo. And I hadn't eaten it yet, and he'd talk about it, and I'd say, well, what does it taste like? What is it like? He said, well, it's kind of like your collard greens. But he had never had collard greens. But he read a lot, and he talked to every American he met, and he would compare things. And he was so connected to what he called the first world when he talked about the United States. He was so connected all the way in Jamaica. From that experience and many others, I realized that we are so much more alike than we are different. And not only in our own culture, but across races and other cultures. Just a couple of weeks ago, we went to Mount Denson to the 120th anniversary of the Mount Denson Church. Pastor Heather Carr, who also was, by the way, ordained that next week in Hansport, so she's all official down there. Down in the valley, we went there. We experienced what I felt was just like the warmth of the old black country church, nestled among the trees on acres of land surrounded by beautiful and lush scenery. The hospitality of our Caucasian brothers and sisters was no less inviting as we are accustomed to in areas where we are more familiar. And the food was like some old down-home Southern cooking. Amen. Our experience, Bill and my experience here throughout Canada and other countries we have visited around the world, highlight the many similarities of God's people all over the world. In fact, I'm reminded, I'm going to call out Minister Debbie on this. When I first came to this church, she may not remember, and I met her, I told her that she reminded me of the people from Fountain Baptist Church in New Jersey. It was almost as if God just picked us up and set us down here, and we were, you're a Fountainite. You remind me so much of so many people there, right? And then the other thing that tied us together is when I went to the first Taste of East Preston and had oxtails. That just showed up. Okay, that is so Facebook and Twitter friends from different parts of the world who I know from different places where I lived or different experiences, when I see one of my friends from one place that knows somebody from a totally different place, or they might even be related, it blows me away that I've known people that have been related, but I've known them separately and never knew there was any connection there. It is so exciting to see how people come together, certainly in social media, but in many different ways, and we are so much alike, more so than we are different. Even when we journeyed to Birchtown, those who went, you remember, for the grand opening of the new museum, we looked on those walls, on that wall, and we saw those names that were listed there. I saw some last names of some people that I know back in the States, right? Right? Those slaves that were taken from Africa to the southern part of the United States, and then those who journeyed to Nova Scotia, some being dropped off in Birchtown and then beyond, some who went all the way back to Africa, but whose names are listed on that wall, names that came from the Book of Negroes, listed by either their birth name, slave name. There is a connection between all of us. God's universal family spans the entire globe. And we here in East Preston join with millions of people all over the world as we gather here to worship our God in spirit and in truth on this Sunday morning. And as a part of God's universal family, we learn that we are all called to a specific work within God's kingdom, and we are all set apart for service to our God, wherever God has planted us. And in our service to God as a part of God's universal church, there are some universal truths that can guide all of us along the way, regardless of where we are, what part of the world we're in, or what we're faced with. We have a standard, a universal truth that has been set and ordained by God to be the standard that we are all to follow in our Christian service. Now, to be sure, we are all called to serve and to witness for the common good. We read that this morning. For the good of all people all over the world. And in this, we began to see God's universal plan for unity all over the world. That which we are fighting so fiercely for right now. And in Galatians 6, this scripture which I've loved for so many years, in this first part, Paul speaks to the standard that God has set for all of us, God's children, universally to follow in our Christian walk and service. A few weeks ago, we looked at the passage just before the scripture that we have for today in Galatians 6. That passage was in Galatians 6, 1 through 5. And we talked about the need for us to care for one another. We learned that God has called us to strengthen one another as we walk along this Christian journey. That our assignment is to help one another and not to seek to destroy anyone else. And remember, Paul taught us that we are also to examine ourselves as we seek to help others so that we don't find ourselves thinking of ourselves individually as better than anybody else. In fact, he warned us in verse 3 that if anyone thinks of himself to be something when he is nothing, he only deceives himself. So Paul taught throughout Galatians what a Christian walk should look like, especially as it related to those who are around us, those who are a part of the household of faith. Now, to be sure, Paul says that we are to care about ourselves, but he also admonishes us to care more about the needs of others. As a backdrop for why we do what we do for Christ. God wants us all to learn what true humility is. When we lay aside our need to be the best or to be the first or to be the strongest or to be the smartest or to be the one, and to accept that only Jesus is the one, the only perfect one, and the rest of us are merely sinners saved by verse 7 of Galatians 6, It says, Paul says, in a somewhat of a tone of a strong rebuke, do not be deceived. Oh, I hear him saying, don't get this twisted. Don't be confused. Let me school you right here and right now. He says, do not be deceived. God is not mocked. God is not to be toyed with. God is not to be fooled around with, or you better not try to trick God. He says, whatever you sow, that shall you also reap. Whatever you put in will determine what you get out. I believe the popular description of this concept is the same as this agricultural kind of process of seed time and harvest. No, that wasn't right, but anyway, whatever you sow, whatever seed you sow into the earth, what you put in will determine what you reap. It will determine what you get back out of the earth, the harvest. Now, to be sure, Paul was talking about how we as God's children ought to treat one another. He said there in verse 6, let him who is taught the word share in all good things with him who teaches. Paul was looking out for the teacher, but he was also looking out for the one to be taught. He was elevating the teaching of the word to a level where we are all to see it as critical to our forward movement in our lives as children of God. But he was also calling forth the givers in us all to make sure that we take care of those who God has sent, and that the one sent takes care of those God has entrusted them with. But then he backs us up and says, be clear. What you put in will determine what you get out. Now change the slide. Everything you need is in the seed you sow. Paul says, for if you sow to the flesh, if you seek to do everything to make your flesh feel good and feel admired and feel noticed, then you will reap corruption from that same flesh. What does he mean, corruption? Well, he means that which happens whenever we follow our flesh. He means that corruption comes whenever we disobey the word of God. When we disobey the word of God, we are rebellious against God. And we fall into the clutches of the enemy that corrupts our thinking and our service to our God. All of a sudden, we don't feel like doing this or that at the church. Or we don't understand why we should have to do this or do that, even if it's clearly set out in God's word. We find ourselves bored. Bored. How do you get bored when you hear the word of God? But we find ourselves bored when we hear the word of God. We find ourselves distracted when there is a call for service from God's people in the world. Our minds become corrupted because we no longer are focused and dependent on God for our daily bread. Oh, sure, Paul told us that in the last days, people will be lovers of themselves rather than lovers of God. And he said that we will have a form of godliness, but we will deny by our actions the very power therein. What he's saying is that our minds can become so corrupted that we will act like we're one way when we're really another. We will sing the songs of Zion while at the same time have hatred in our hearts. We will give to those who are in need, but we will show up, make sure somebody knows that we gave it. Our minds can become so corrupted that our flesh determines what we do. But he says still in verse 8, but if you sow to the Spirit, oh my, he says, you will then reap of the Spirit. And he says you'll reap everlasting life. Sow to the flesh what you want or what you desire, and you reap corruption from the flesh. Sow to the Spirit, God's way, God's instruction, and you reap everlasting life. A place in God's kingdom. Our world is designed to appeal to our flesh. 1 John 2:16 says, for everything in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life is not from the Father of God, but it is from the world. Our world is designed to appeal to the very thing that Paul says we should not operate from. Our world is structured around enhancing our flesh. Our world operates in line with our flesh. That is why we see evil happening every day, and we cannot understand how people can do such horrendous things to other people. And that is why there is so much hatred on the mouths of so many people when they consider others of different races. Yeah.
Self-worth,
that they too can be welcomed is truly all about. Yes, it is about service. Yes, it includes some suffering and some strife sometimes. And yes, those who serve the Lord will have to carry some burdens sometimes, even the burdens of others who God has called them to serve. But He wants us all to know that if we can just hold out, if we can just keep the faith, if we can suffer for a little while, if we can keep our focus right, God will bless us in due season, in His perfect time. God will bless us in His appointed time. That Kairos time that is perfectly appointed. And God will do just what He said He would do. Well, I don't know about you, but I remember the scripture that says that weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. And I've had some of those dark and lonely nights. Oh, joy might not be there right now in your life, but God says joy comes out. Joy comes out. Joy, He says, comes in the morning. But as Paul says in 2 Corinthians, that this light affliction, which is in God's timing, but for a moment, that in the end it shall produce for us a greater weight of glory, an eternal weight of glory. And I am waiting on the promises of God, because God is always faithful to His promises. Amen. He's always faithful to His promises. He says there in verse 10 in closing, therefore, as we have opportunity, as you and I have opportunity, brothers and sisters, that's every day and all throughout the day, we have opportunity. He says, let us do good to all. Do good to everyone we meet. And then he says, especially signifying that there is a special group that God wants us to look out for, he says, let us do good to all, especially to those who are of the household of faith. I don't have this down, but why is it that church sometimes is the hardest place to be? Because we don't treat each other right. He says, especially do good to those who are of the household of faith. That's the church. Those who are saved, forgiven, and who have received everlasting life. Brothers and sisters, as we learn and grow, and as we love and serve, we are storing up treasures in heaven that our God delights in. What we put in to our Christian journey will directly determine what we get out of it. It's not a trick game, nor is it a deceptive plot or plan. It falls in line with the principles of seed time and harvest. Found in Genesis chapter 8, says as long as the earth endures, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night shall never cease. So if we hold